Hello, everybody.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to How to Write a Better Life Story. I'm Annette, and I'm broadcasting from California, and I'm with Danny, who is in Washington right now. We appreciate all of you being here today because this topic is kind of close to our hearts. You know, we know that we have been able to write a better life story for ourselves, and we're hoping that you'll get some ideas on how to do the same for yourself. Before we actually get started, though, we do need to go over a little bit of the logistics of it all. So first off, we definitely want you to ask questions. And you can do so by going to lifelisted.com/live and clicking on the button that says Ask a Question. There's also a link on the blog post itself. And of course, this will be recorded and it'll be available for free viewing on YouTube and also on this post.
Awesome. Thanks, Annette. I'm super excited about this. So Annette and I have known each other for years at this point. We're both super involved with bucket lists. She has multiple bucket lists. I only have one, so she beat me there. We originally met in Barcelona, kind of creeped out because we were just people that we had read about each other on the internet. But since then, we've been having, I'd say, monthly calls like this, just talk about, hey, what are we working on? How can we support each other? So we're excited to finally bring this to all of you and do it in a Q&A format, because I think that's the more beneficial rather than just talking at you. We want to talk with you. I know she has a lot to bring to the table. I specifically admire Annette because I know there's a growing number of people who have situations like mine where I'm a single guy who knows a lot of technology stuff, and that's how I funded this. And we'll go into the details of exactly what that means. But Annette is doing this in a totally different way, but I think she's got a priority straight, focusing on a bucket list and on her family and doing it that way. And I really admire that a lot about her. And I'm eager to dive
Thank
more
you.
Into that about like exactly like what is this day-to-day of yours? How do you fund all this? All those questions we typically get asked.
That was so sweet. Thank you. So I guess I'll start by formally introducing myself.
Please.
I'm Annette, and I have the site Bucket List Journey. I consider myself a new experience collector. So I travel the world in search of bucket list worthy experiences. I am on a mission to kind of check off things from my own list, but I'm also trying to find things that would be worthy to put on somebody else's list too. Last year, I have such an obsession with bucket lists that it took me to 5 different continents and 13 countries, and I don't even know how many cities, but some great experiences happen, like swimming in Jellyfish Lake in Micronesia and going on safari in Africa and so many other things. But as Danny said, I also have a family. I don't have children, but I am married. And I own a restaurant in my town in Northern California. So I do try to balance a husband and actually running a restaurant along with a bucket list. So that's kind of where I'm at.
Yeah, I have no idea how you do it, but it's pretty cool to read about all of your stories while making it happen.
Thank you.
Yeah. Quick introduction of myself. So my name is Danny Dover. I run a website called Life Listed. I take a little bit of a different avenues than Annette does. So I've made the purpose of my life to complete my bucket list. So I have a deadline, May 25th, 2017. Take it very, very seriously. I got this tattooed on me, actually. And I've been working on this now for the last, say, 3 years or so. More or less full-time. So like I'll get a job, but the job is so I can pursue the bucket list, or I'll move some to a different city and the reason that I'm there is so I can work on the bucket list, that kind of thing. The bucket list itself is about 150 items. I now have 23 left, so I'm getting towards the end, which is very exciting. some of the bigger ones on the list that I've done, I've been to, I think, close to 70 countries or something like that. I haven't really counted. Climb mountains in Antarctica, one of my favorites. I became a published author.
Nice.
I've actually done this one twice now, I've just realized, but about a same-day ticket to a country I've never heard of. So luckily for me, I'm quite naive with geography or geography, so at least I was. And so I keep finding these countries I've never heard of. I did a talk show last year, and I've completed almost the entire list, which is pretty crazy. A couple of sort of fun facts about me. So I'm a self-declared minimalist, so I only own about 150 things, although frankly I'm a little bit over that because I recently started obsessing over video production stuff, so that gets complicated. But yeah, I own about 150 things total. So when I travel, I bring everything with me, and it's all carry-on in one bag. And professionally, I'm a writer, online marketer, and a very, very, very amateur filmmaker. mostly just YouTube videos.
Accounts.
So let's get into this. That's enough about us. We want to talk more about everybody else. We want to start talking about this theme of how to write a better life story. So I guess the first way to do this is talk about how Annette and I have worked on our separate life stories and what we've done to better them, and what some things that you can copy, some of the things that we've learned along the way. So I guess I'll start here. But the way that I started this journey is I was going through a rough time in my life. I was dealing with depression and was just really not happy. I wasn't feeling settled. I had certain areas of my life that were going well, and then lots of areas of my life that just were stagnant. They just weren't doing anything. And I started reading a lot and started reading about these people who had missions in their lives, something they really cared a lot about. A lot of these books were cheesy and old. It would be like knights and like these like superheroes and that kind of stuff. And I got tired of it, and I wanted, like, you know, why don't I get to do any of this stuff? So I gave myself this arbitrary list, and it started small and disorganized, all these things. And I also didn't have any money at the time, so it started with the really cheap things. and just started doing things that were local and small. And then it started building. And as I gained more momentum, my life course really changed a lot, and I started to obsess over this and make it a permanent fixture of my life and get the deadline and all these things. Annette, what was your experience when you first getting started with your list?
Well, I've always been a list maker, but kind of not official bucket list, but agreed I had some anxiety issues, and so I thought, you know what, maybe this bucket list thing, I can write it down, it'll start helping me a little bit, conquer some of my fears that I have had. So that's kind of how I got started, and then once I started doing things and accomplishing goals, I couldn't stop. There was something in me that just loved the feeling of accomplishing something. I was really proud of myself, and it wasn't for other people to be proud of me, but just because in myself it was making me feel so good about, oh my God, I had such a fear of that, and now I've done it. So that's kind of how I got started, and then it just snowballed from there. Now I can't stop.
Well, that's a good thing. Let's see. Benefits of a bucket list. So I have a couple that I have, and I think Annette has some more. For me, one of the bigger aspects of this has just been it's given me a larger scope. So my viewpoint used to be very like, what can I get done this week, or what do I need to focus on right now? And the nice thing about a bucket list is it's given me a much longer term plan. So my deadline is 4 years out at this point. So a lot of the thinking I do is more of like a 4 or 5 year plan, which I found to be really helpful because I stop worrying about the problems that are directly in front of my face, and I start worrying about problems that are bigger so that I can start conquering those. And it's nice because it allows me to help other people more, and it allows me to focus on more important, like purposeful aspects of my life. Mm-hmm. It's defined. So like Annette, I'm really obsessed with lists. So that's really nice that I can wake up every morning and know exactly what I'm going to be working on and exactly what I'm going to do. Paradoxically to this, my favorite parts of the list, and I'm sure Annette, and I know this is something we've talked about, the things I like the most are the things that happen in between. So like I'll have a bucket list item to go to, say, like Spain, to like Barcelona. And I'll meet really cool people while I'm there, things that I didn't expect at all. Or I'll have some kind of food that I've never had before. And it's those things that are unwritten and not listed. Those are things that really, I think, bring the most excitement to this list and the most fulfillment.
Yeah.
Annette, some benefits?
I agree that it's like, it gives you a little bit of conquering your fears, for one. And a sense of accomplishment, like I talked about before, but it also provides structure to your life a little bit. Like you said, you wake up in the morning and you kind of know what you're going to work on. You know, I do pick things off my list and say, oh yeah, today I can do this. Instead of going through the monotony of day to day, you know, there's a little something extra that I can do to make it different or to have a new experience. And that's kind of how I thrive. So that's truly a benefit for me. And plus, like you said, like writing it down, having it on paper or wherever you may keep it, it also turns it into more of a plan than just an idea. You know, mm-hmm. So it's like even if you're not working towards it, you know that it's a plan, that it is something that you want to do. And so the next step is picking, you know, what first step you're going to take towards that goal.
So let's dive in. Let's get to that point. So let's pretend I've never had a list before. How do I get started on this?
I think the best way to get started is kind of just brainstorm initially is how to get started and ask yourself a few questions like, where have you always wanted to travel to, or what sport have you always wanted to participate in? Is there something that you and your family have always been wanting to do? And then write all those things. But I get inspiration from everywhere now. I can read a magazine, look at a blog, watch TV, and I have a quick story. Last night I was at work, and one of the employees was doing some weird thing, and he was like taking his hands, and he was going like this, and I'm thinking this kid needs medication. I don't know if he can work here.
Literally,
and I'm like, what are you doing? He said, I'm practicing gloving. And I said, what is gloving? And he's like, it's this thing that they do at raves where they wear these white gloves and they put lights on the fingertips. And so I ended up Googling this gloving thing. And that was like just one other way to get an idea for my list. I'm thinking, I got to go to a rave and see how they do this thing, or I have to do it myself. So I think you can find inspiration anywhere. It depends on your mindset and if you're looking for it. You know, I think probably with you too, our minds are now sort of trained to see something. You know, it's something catches my interest really quick, like, okay, I want to do that, and I'll add it to my list really quick, whereas some people might have to look a little deeper to find something. Mm-hmm.
You wrote a blog post a while back that it combined a bunch of bucket list items that you'd found. Is that right? Do you remember how I can find that, or what the name of it was, maybe, so I can Google it?
I think that what you're talking about is the Ultimate Bucket List Resource Guide.
Yes, that's right.
And it has everything. Yeah, it has how to find things for your list and where you can store your list and why write one, how to write one. It has everything on there.
Good. Okay, we got some questions streaming in, so I'm going to take a little break in the agenda we have at this point, and then we'll go back to it after we answer a couple questions. So the first one that we have is, who wrote this? It looks like Steve-O. I don't know which Steve-O it is. But he said, what do you do about overcoming fear? So that's kind of a deep one. Annette, you want to take this one first, and then I'll answer
it? Sure. For me, several years ago, I made myself a promise to not let fear make my decisions for me. So now, whenever an opportunity presents itself, I always ask myself, is my answer related to fear? You know, am I saying no because I'm afraid? And if I took away that fear, would I say yes? And most of the time, it is because of fear that I would say no, so I make myself say yes. So that's just like a little promise that I made to myself, but it has led to so many amazing opportunities that if I let the fear control it, I would have never done. I mean, for example, I'm really afraid of flying. I travel all over the world. I don't know if I'll ever be comfortable flying, but I work through it. You know, I found that if I am in the right mindset and I know that this is taking me to a better place, this flight, you know, I think you just have to work through your fears and just face them head on. And things aren't as scary the more you do them, too.
Yeah.
You know, if the first time you do something, it's really scary, like riding the subway in London. The first time I did that, I was terrified. I'd never been on a metro before or anything. And now you feel so empowered because you can go anywhere in the world and catch a metro. And I'm like, okay, I know how this works. It's all kind of the same. And so I just think you have to keep doing something to kind of conquer the fear also.
Do you have like a little like procedure or like little tricks you do for getting preparing to fly?
Well, there used to be a video online, I can't remember what it was called, that I watched about, you know, the mechanics of a flight, and they took you through how safe it was, and safer than driving, and I used to like that video, so I would watch that, but now I'm beyond that. So I found if I entertain myself with a couple of different things, like I'll have headphones in, listen to music while I'm writing something, or looking at a magazine. So if I have two forms distracting me, it works for me.
That's
and if that doesn't work, you know, I'll have a little glass of wine. That works.
That makes a lot of sense to me. So my trick for overcoming fear is very similar to yours. Is I'll just pursue little pieces of it. So let's say I am afraid of public speaking. What I'll do is I'll just speak in front of one person, like a friend, for example.
Yeah.
And then I'll do like two people, and I'll do three people. And I'll just break I'll break whatever it is I'm afraid of, and I'll break it down into as small of a chunk as I possibly can and tackle that, and then just keep going. And I found the way to overcome every single fear that I've ever been able to overcome is just perseverance. It's just continually whittling away at it. And really, even like every kind of goal that I think I've had in my life, the way to do it is to like just be relentless about going after it, even if it's small baby steps every single day. That's the way that I've really been able to do it with fears and goals in general. The next question we have up is from Alan. He said, what is Danny's shoe size? I think I wear like a 11. 11D. You want to buy me some shoes or something? I'm not expecting that.
That's funny.
I'm sure I got a bunch of different like random friends. Al I know. He's someone I admire who lives in Chicago area. And so I think it's always fun to see him because this guy kicks butt at YouTube, and so I kind of like stalk him on YouTube to see how he's doing. So it's funny he's doing that in reverse to me right now. Let's see, next question on here is how do you afford the items on your list? So this is the big question. This comes up all the time. Annette and I do this in very different ways, which I think is really interesting. Annette, if you want to tackle this first, then I'll give you a bigger, broader answer.
Well, like I said, I do have a restaurant, so that does provide, fortunately, a stable income for me. But I'm also extremely cheap. You know, I am not a shopper. I am not one of those girls who my favorite Saturday thing to do is go shopping, spend money, have lunch. You know, I'm not that person. I would rather stay home and research a new, you know, country than go buy new shoes, unless I really needed the shoes, like mine were broken. But I do, also blogging has helped me a lot to fund some of the travel. I've been very, very lucky to be offered some opportunities through that, so that has been helpful. But kind of like you were saying, when you started and you were doing the cheap things, it's the same too. Even when I started and when I didn't have stable finances, I would do, and there's so many things you can do that don't cost much. Like even giving blood was something I did. I went to the movies alone or went to dinner alone. I took a new route to work. I hiked a new trail. There's so many things that you can do that don't cost a lot too. So.
Yeah, I agree. That's exactly how I started. I started before I had, in fact, I was in a lot of debt when I first started this project.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what I did initially, was I just started with things that were free or cheaper, right, where you're donating something. That's in theory cheaper, I think.
Yeah.
And I did things that were local because transportation used to be a big issue for me. So I did things like that. And then when I first started, it was also things that were like focused on me, which isn't like a nice thing to say, but it's true. Like I was very overweight when I first started, so I started doing things like running, which is free and also really beneficial, and then leads to other benefits, which save me money in the long term, health-wise. Yeah. So things like that, or eating better or just less. Less ended up being cheaper than eating better, because at least here in the States, it's expensive to eat well.
Right.
I did things like that. And then to actually afford it, like the point-blank answer to that is I do marketing consulting. So my income comes from that. Generally, it's overall marketing strategy for different companies, mostly based in the U.S., but that's how I make my income, is doing that.
I think it's like what you were saying, too, about staying local and doing things. I think a lot of people take for granted what's kind of in their own backyard, and I know I'm one of those people.
Me too.
And, you know, I've been home now for a few weeks from traveling, and it makes me focus more on what's kind of near me and what to do in the surrounding area, because there is so much stuff. We just think that nobody cares. Because we live there instead of going somewhere else. So
yeah.
I would always say look for things right in your own backyard.
Yeah, I've been working on this. I don't know if it'll turn into a short story or what it was, but it's this concept that I'm calling, like the working project name is living in your Ferrari. So the way I used to view travel was that it was something that I would do after everything else had been handled. So like it was my luxury would be travel. I would finally get all my work done. I would have all the other responsibilities taken care of, and then I would travel. And now when I look at travel, it's very different. Like most of my plane tickets are bought on miles, so they don't actually cost me anything anymore.
Right.
And these are the things that I do first, and then everything else is luxury. So as cheesy as it might sound, like my vacation's more now when I come home because I'm outside. I'm traveling most of the year. My vacation's when I come back. I guess more to come on that because it's still an idea I'm working on, but it was a big perspective change for me, just how I viewed the luxury of travel. Now it's just how I live my day on a day-to-day. It's not particularly luxurious.
Right. Becomes a lifestyle. It's just normal. You know, people are like, well, what are you going to do when you have to go back to normal? I'm like, this is normal. You know, this is how we have set up our life. So to me, traveling all the time seems normal. You know, completing goals seems normal. So.
Yeah, I feel exactly the same way. And I mean, I feel a lot of gratitude for that because it took a long time to get there, but now it is not a big deal for me to, say, run my business when I'm remote or to do these things that used to just seem like huge problems or huge hurdles that would just be incredibly difficult to get over. Now mm-hmm. it's just my day-to-day, and I don't even give those a second thought most of the time.
Right. Yeah. Agreed.
We have another question here. We actually have a lot of questions, so I appreciate everyone's input on these. This one is, do you speak Arabic? And I do not speak Arabic yet. Perhaps no. It's something I should work on. I was talking to Niall Doherty, who runs a blog called Disrupt the Rabblement, and one of his big, big ambitious goals in his life to do, and give you context on this guy, he's right now circumnavigating the globe without using airplanes. So this is a guy who dreams big.
Oh my gosh.
He's made it most of the way at this point. But crazy. His big ambitious goal is to learn the world's five most popular languages. And the math works out that if you learn those five languages, you can speak to, I think, 75% of the world's population, which is pretty
very
cool.
Very interesting.
Thing. Yeah, Arabic is one of them. That's why I brought
is
that.
It?
Mm-hmm. Continuing on the agenda, let's see. Afford, fears. If anyone has follow-up questions on those two, the way to do it is go to lifelisted.com/live. That'll bring you to a Google Hangouts thing. There should be a button there that says Q&A, or you have to hit play, and then you can ask any questions. That's the way to do it in real time for us. Okay, here is a little bit of a longer one. This one is from both Daniel, who asked it on lifelisted.com, and Himanshu, who is a good friend of mine, who asked it on Facebook. Do you fear the day you complete the last item on your bucket list, because then you have nothing excited to be about going forward? So, Annette, you kind of touched on this earlier.
Yeah.
But what are you afraid about? What will happen when this lifestyle is over?
My bucket list doesn't have an end to it, so I don't feel like it's gonna be over. And though I do take, with that said, I do take steps to continue this lifestyle. You know, I do know that I need finances to travel. I need mm-hmm. certain things to live the lifestyle, to complete bucket list items. So, you know, every day I do work on taking steps so that I don't have to go back and not live this lifestyle. But I don't see an end, so I don't fear it.
Yeah, I think that's a great
answer.
I don't fear. I mean, so there's a big difference with how Annette and I manage our list. So hers is open-ended, and she continues to add things to it, which is great. I go a different route. I have a very strict deadline, and I have a very strict rule of not adding or removing anything from the list. The reason I did this was because my list, when I first started, it kept growing and growing and growing, and I realized that if I didn't prioritize it, I was never going to finish the whole thing. So for me, finishing the whole thing is very important. For Annette, hers is more open-ended, more of a journey. Like her blog, it talks about bucket list journey. Mine's more like life-listed, right? It's a definitive list.
Yeah.
So the question then that a couple people are asking is, am I afraid about the day when it ends? And the answer is no, I'm really not. So my bucket list will end before the deadline of May 25th, 2017. So hopefully I'll finish it a couple years before that. But then I'm going to keep traveling. What I've really learned is like the power that I've felt, like the self-power and the self-confidence that I've felt from learning how to travel and doing things like Annette was mentioning, riding the tube for the first time. Now I can go to any city, and I've done this multiple times now, where I'll go to some city. I don't know anyone on maybe the entire continent. I don't speak the local language, and I don't know what I'm doing there. But I've done this so many times and overcome those fears that now I feel great doing that, and it's really an empowering thing. So I'm going to continue to do this going forward. I'm going to continue to do bucket list items. It will just not be as strict as my current list is. Okay, next question up is from Marco. He asked this on Facebook. He said, I have a small family. Let me see if I can summarize this. So my question is, in Marco's case, he has a small family, and that's where his priorities are, and that's where his time and resources mm-hmm. go towards. And he said, what are your thoughts on, is it possible to complete this list when you are a family guy, as he describes it? And I'll let you tackle this first, and then I have...
Yes, it's possible. you know what I would suggest, too, is creating a list surrounding his family. Mm-hmm. So many people do that, and I actually have a summer bucket list on my blog, all the fun things you can do with a family during the summer. There's so many things you can complete as a family, but also get them on board to help support you, too. I know even with my staff at work, it's fun for them to ask me, what are you doing now, and how can I help you? And they can't wait to see the pictures. And so, you know, if he lets his family in, maybe they can support him in some way to do some of the things on his own, but also to create a list that involves them, too, so they feel like they're a part of something.
Yep, I think that's absolutely right. I know that when I first started this, what I obsessed over was the money question of how am I going to afford these bigger things.
Yeah.
And that is extremely important, and there's absolutely no getting around that. But at the same time, I think my priorities were wrong when I was approaching it that way. What I should have been doing is how can I involve more people with this, and then that generally helps answer the question because you can
right.
you can spread costs around. I know a lot of people who are traveling the world right now with little kids. Leigh Shulman, who writes a blog called The Future is Red, she does a fantastic job about this. And she has two kids. One is, I believe, a newborn, and she goes to crazy places and does that.
Right.
In Spain, I was talking to my friend Cecilia, who, when she had a newborn, she decided to go hiking around China and made that mm-hmm. happen. And then I know people who have older families who are doing it with their grandparents. I can certainly see all the reasons why this would be difficult, and it absolutely is. But there's lots and lots of people who I know firsthand are doing this. They're doing bucket lists with their family, and I think it's right. an important part of their family structure.
And what a great thing to teach your children, too, mm-hmm. is that, you know, you can have a goal, you have a dream, and you can achieve that dream. And maybe it's a lot of hard work, but you can do it. You know, I would think that would be just a great thing to pass down to your children.
Yeah. And again, with the money thing, so you're right, it is very expensive to get, say, hotels somewhere like Hawaii and plane right. tickets to get to Hawaii and all these things. But I think you'll get as much out of it if you do something as simple as like a free hike somewhere nearby that maybe you've never
right.
been to with a family.
Yeah. There's a lot of ideas, yeah.
Yeah. Good question, Marco. I like that one.
Yeah.
We have Jim who emailed me this question. What's your best travel resource? And then I'll let you go first on this one.
My best travel resource is, I'm going to say it's the compass on my iPhone. You know, as soon as I learned that I can use the compass without actually having an internet connection, I didn't get lost half as much when I was in a different country. That I use that a lot, and then TripAdvisor as far as a website goes. I know it's pretty common and it's no big secret, but I really do love TripAdvisor. I think I look for all my flights on there, and I like to read the reviews. So,
yeah,
those two things.
I like that.
What about you?
Let's see. So TripAdvisor as well. Lonely Planet also. I search for most of my flights on kayak.com because I found they do a better job of incorporating all the budget airlines. I use HipMonk for most of my lodging, and I use Airbnb all the time because it turns out to be cheaper than hotels.
Right.
And then I guess just the internet at large. I mean, that's how I answer all my questions of that
agreed.
Kind of stuff. Yeah. I only just started to get local SIM cards when I travel to different countries. I used to just be, because it is kind of a confusing process of like, you have to have your phone unlocked and you have to make sure it's on the right thing and then you have to buy the SIM card and then you have to get all the data and sometimes you have to do this in different language. So it's hard. But after I finally got over that fear and that logistical problem, now my life when I've been traveling is so much easier when I have local SIM coverage, so I have a little bit of data. Because again, you can use maps, you can email if you need to, you can look up Lonely Planet, you can do all these kind of things that just make little things way easier. Google Translate is huge, but you need to have some kind of internet access for it to work. So as of late, my most important travel resource has been just getting a local SIM card.
Right. How'd you get your unlocked phone?
I had to. I just bought it in the States.
Oh.
So I've
yeah.
Go ahead.
Go ahead. Oh, I was gonna say I had mine unlocked too, but I had it done through AT&T, so it was an option for free to have it unlocked if you had their service for so long. So just so people know that is an option to kind of call maybe your provider and see if they can unlock it. But I think most people are probably buying the unlocked phones already.
Good point. I forgot that carriers can do that for you for free. I know T-Mobile does it for free also.
Yeah.
So that's a good point there. Jessica on Twitter, the most interesting person you've met while traveling. That's a good one.
I met a storm chaser once at the airport, which I thought it was pretty cool. But I would say that probably the person I was most fascinated with was when we were in Tanzania, Africa. We had dinner with somebody from the Maasai tribe. Which is a tribe in Africa. They live in huts, and they have such a different lifestyle. And we were able to ask him all the questions about how they lived and, you know, the dynamics of their family. And it is so different than anything I was used to. I just found him really, really fascinating.
Interesting. That has been my favorite part of traveling, is just these crazy people that you meet. And crazy, yeah. I mean that in a really good way. I mean, not only are you meeting people who have just totally different lifestyles and backgrounds than you, but you also meet people who have made travel an essential part of their life as well. It's just inherent in traveling. You're going to meet other travelers. And those are the people I've really loved surrounding myself with, because one, we have a lot in common, and two, you can learn from their travel experiences of places to go and not go and things to not screw up and that kind of stuff.
Right.
Let's see, a couple people who I've met, took a little notes on this. So let's see, my friend Joseph, who is one of the most talented computer scientists in the world, but he's also just a crazy DJ, so he kind of travels around the world, and he funds it by doing crazy computer science stuff, which I don't understand, but then spends most of his time DJing and just being crazy and weird.
Fun.
Yeah. I've met two people who, from what I can tell, are... like special agents or secret agents, so of course they're not going to ever tell me that directly. but given the clues that I had at the time and then what I was able to do research later and then talking to other friends about how they described their job and that kind of thing, I think I've met two, but again, that's something hard to verify.
Yeah.
And then just other bucket list bloggers, so there's, I mean,
right.
And that's one of my favorites, but there's other ones as well, and so it's been fun to mm-hmm. go out and meet other people doing this similar kind of things.
That is kind of such a benefit to traveling, is that you have friends all over the world, or you meet interesting people all over the world, you know, that I can connect with still through social media or whatnot, who will always have a bed for me, you know, or a couch for me wherever I am. So that's really been nice.
Yeah, yeah. Let's get into some more like logistical stuff of like what can people do to actively make their lives better, to write a better life story here. So if you want to talk, let's see if I can tie this in with one of the questions. That would be the best way to do this.
Start a bucket list?
Yes, I guess let's talk about that. So for me, like the way that I've created a better life story for me is through this bucket list project and through this life mission. And Annette has done the same. I'm trying to think if there's other ways of doing it, or if there's more like concrete steps I can give people for writing a better story. I'm keeping this kind of open-ended, and that's maybe a little more
difficult. I think that people do have to find out what they want their life to be, though, too. You know, it's like we enjoy bucket lists, and some people might not like that, or they don't like the terminology of it, or what it signifies. I think people have to find out, you know, what are they passionate about, and then figure out, well, how can I take the steps to move to that goal and not be scared? So, I mean, if somebody's passionate about, I don't know, sailing, and that's their only life dream is to have a sailboat and sail around the world, I don't know what it is, but to take that one goal and to break it down into just tiny little goals, you know, and every day kind of do something, whether it's research sailboats, you know, find out a budget for how much it costs, you know, or whatever it is, but I think it's individual to each person, because not everybody's going to be a bucket list fanatic like us.
Right.
Some people may just have one goal, or it's a family goal or something like that. So I think the first step would be to define what would make your life better. You know, what do you think would make a better life story, and then take the steps on how to get there.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. I think that makes a lot of sense. The way that you and I happen to be doing it, I don't think is the right solution for everyone, but I think this idea of trying to understand what you want to do, putting yourself in new experience and meeting new people,
mm-hmm.
I would say that is a pretty surefire way to improve your life, is just to get out and open up your mind a little bit.
Agreed.
Yeah. Let's see. We have more of a practical question here. This is from Jennifer, who asked this on an old blog post. Any tips for dealing with jet lag? Have you become immune to it? It's a follow-up question.
As a matter of fact, the older I get, the worse it gets.
Yeah.
But I do the normal stuff. You know, I try to adjust a few days before I leave to the other time. I always make sure that I'm really well rested before I get on a plane, because I don't want to already be tired when I get on the plane. Then I can't sleep on the plane, and then it just kind of you know, snowballs into something terrible. So I try to make sure I'm well rested. I try not to book flights that are crazy, like 5 a.m, where it's going to make me tired. And then when I arrive, I always stay awake until the local time bedtime. So even if I arrive at like 3 o'clock, I will stay awake till an early bedtime, like maybe 8 o'clock, and then I'll go to sleep. And so it kind of makes me adjust a little bit faster. On the way home, I'm pretty much screwed. I haven't figured that out. I'm always tired. I just try not to fight it. If I'm tired, I nap. But on the way home is always worse for me.
Yeah, I mean, I echo everything you said there. I wish I had some kind of secret pill or something.
Yeah.
But I don't. I do exactly what you do, which is as soon as I get to the airport, I try to adjust to the time zone that I'm going to. So if I have to force myself to be awake, I do that with coffee. If I need to go to sleep, I'm not really a fan of sleeping pills, so I try to go to sleep. And then when I get home, I do the essentially reverse of that. So I'll just force myself to adjust to the new time zone by staying up awake with coffee again, or I'll just go to sleep even if it doesn't make sense with my body. I'll just lay in bed and roll around, basically. But I don't have some magical answer for that.
Yeah.
Ooh, this is a good one for you. So this is from James. I got this one from an email. Best meal that you've had?
That's a tough question for me.
Yeah, I know. That's what
the best meal. You know, as far as like traveling goes, every meal for me that kind of immerses you into their culture, I've loved. You know, even when I was in Africa, they took us to eat ugali, which is like a stiff polenta, and it's kind of tasteless, to be honest. And it wasn't the best tasting, but I loved being immersed in their culture. But if I had to pick a best, like, meal, I would say SPQR in San Francisco was probably one of my most memorable evenings out, because for me, a meal is about everything. It's not just about the food. It's about your company, your wine, the ambiance of the restaurant. It's about so many different things, and that was just a perfect blend of, I like to eat weird food too, so they have like pig's feet on the menu and blood sausage, but they disguised it so well, it was like the most delicious pig's feet you would ever eat. It was just a great, great evening, so SPQR San Francisco.
All right.
That was great. How cool. About you?
So I'm not much of a foodie, to be completely honest. Like, yeah. A lot of times I'll just get food just for the sake of fuel. But I've had a couple of meals that have really stood out to me. So I think the best meal I've ever had was a specific pizzeria place, which I'll have to add to this blog post. I don't remember the name of it. But it was in Italy. It was in Florence. I think it was called Spira Pizza. So now I don't have to add to the post. Yeah, Spira Pizza in there. And it was just it was like three ingredients. I think it was even like a margarita pizza. But it was just so fresh and so like each ingredient was so flavorful. It was something I'd never experienced before. I really enjoyed that. And then off the same kind of thing, I was just recently in Japan, and I was blown away by how good Japanese food was. So even though I'm from the Pacific Northwest, I'm not much of a fish eater. But what I'm now learning kind of later than probably I should is that when I was growing up, I was just eating bad fish.
Right.
And now that I've had access to good fish, sometimes for pretty cheap, I realized how good fish can be. So Japan was a great source of this. And then all the other things that Japan offered. So it wasn't just food, like sushi. In fact, there's not a lot of sushi that's readily available in Japan. Yeah. It was more like the noodle dishes, having lots and lots of different barbecue, the local pancake kind of things, all the desserts, all the pastries, all those things. So
right.
Most meals that I had in Japan were outstanding. Yeah. Next question is from Liz on email, and I guess let me interrupt myself here. If anyone would like to ask more questions, the simplest way to do this is go to lifelisted.com/live. That'll bring you to the page you need to be on, and then from there, I hit a little button that says Q&A, or I think it might also just be a play button. And from there, you can ask us questions live, and we can address it through here. But in the meantime, Liz, who asked me this over email, who are you reading? It's a good question. So Ned, I'll let you go first.
Currently, I am reading Little Woman because it's a classic, and on my bucket list is to reread a classic just to see if they're as boring as I thought when I was younger. So that's what I'm currently reading. But I'm always reading something. A lot of times I'll read entrepreneurial books, you know, like 4-hour work week or something to do with restaurants or cookbooks. And then I'll do some mindless reading sometimes too, or travel books. But that's what I'm reading right now.
Yep. That's a good idea of going back and reading one of the classics. I know that when I was growing up, when you're forced to read something, you lose all.
Yeah.
You know, it's no longer art. It now becomes an assignment. So that's a good item. I might have to add that to my other list. What am I reading now? So let's see. I just finished reading a book by John Godard, who's the guy who coined the term life list. So this was a guy who, unfortunately, he just passed away, but one of his major life list items was to kayak the entire distance of the Nile. So he kayaked with a crew of three.
Oh, my gosh.
That's kind of a big bucket list item. So this book was called Kayak Down the Nile, and it was writing about that. Really, really good. He's actually written two books, and the first one, I mean, I respect the hell out of this guy. His first book was not good. His second book, though, Kayak Down the Nile, was very, very good, and I definitely recommend it. And then lots of bloggers, and then lots of YouTube people of late. So my favorite blogger, I would say, is Tynan, who writes about all kinds of stuff, minimalism and just life in general, and all these crazy things he gets himself into. I really like Sonia Gill's work a lot. So she does video travel like tips, so she's on YouTube. A guy named Evan Carpenter. He hasn't done an episode for a while, but he used to do some really, really great like travel kind of posts and video posts. I read Annette's blog. I read.
Oh, good answer.
You're like waiting for it, right?
Yeah.
And I read any bucket list related blog that I can find. I'll sign up for it and just read it and see what's going on in the space and what are people doing and what can I learn from them, that kind of thing. This one's from Rachel. Best advice for a new traveler. That's a hard open-ended one.
Best advice for a new traveler. If you're a woman, don't bring heels anywhere. I think my first few trips I was bringing heels. I think one of my first trips was to Italy. And the cobbled streets, I mean, it was just the most impractical thing ever. And so don't do that. I think kind of what I was touching on before is realize that things are only scary the first few times that you're going to do them, you know. So don't be intimidated too much by something. Just give it a shot and know that maybe next time it's going to be a little bit easier for you to do. And also don't be afraid if something happens to your plans and things don't go as expected, because that's what travel's all about. I am, of course, a huge list maker. I love my itineraries and I want to do everything that's on them, but sometimes it doesn't work out, so don't get frustrated. Just kind of look for a different opportunity that might present itself in the area.
Yeah, one of the biggest learnings I've had from traveling is patience. There's just no getting around it. You have to have a lot of it, and it adds up. I'd say my best advice for a new traveler is to pack lighter than you expect. So I used to overpack everything. And what I realized kind of too late was that, you know what, they sell things like soap and toothpaste and shoes and things in every country I've ever been to. Like even the most remote places I've been, I can find something simple like some soap, right? So overpacking toiletries and overpacking clothes is a silly mistake to make, but it's something that I did as a new traveler, and I think lots of people do. So just remember, you can buy things elsewhere. And more importantly than that, it's much cheaper to buy things elsewhere. If you grew up in the States and you're going somewhere that's still developing, it's much cheaper to buy them elsewhere.
Right. You know what? And one more thing, too, is that I think you have to get over your fear of feeling stupid. That was huge for me in the beginning. You know, I didn't speak a language, so I didn't want to ask anybody because I was afraid they were going to be mad because I didn't speak whatever language. You know, there was just so many things I wouldn't ask questions because I was afraid of looking stupid and all that. But once I got over that and realized I'm probably never going to see these people again, so I'm going to ask everybody until I get the answer I need, it made things a lot easier.
Yeah, I totally agree. That's I feel stupid all the time when I'm traveling.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Part of it.
Yeah.
It's a good humbling experience. I need more. Great point. Okay, so we have about 15 more minutes. We still have some questions that are on deck, so I appreciate the people asking that. If you have not yet asked the questions you want to, again, you can go to lifelisted.com/live. In fact, it's Can I point to it? It's right there. Yeah. And you have to click on the button that says Q&A. And then from there, you can ask a question. With that said, we have a question from Andrew. We ever explore other parts of Africa, sans Egypt? I think there's a pun intended there, too. So the only place I've been in Africa is Egypt. I don't think that's true for Annette, though.
I was in Tanzania, and though I currently don't have plans to return to Africa, I don't not have plans to return to Africa either. You know, I would love to go back. I mean, when I was there, I was doing safari, and then we went to a school and an orphanage, and it was so wonderful that I would love to go back and do that, but I would like to spend more time maybe teaching English at the school, or you know, volunteering for a lengthy amount of time at an orphanage or something like that. I would like to return to do that.
Yeah, and I have a similar answer. So I was actually really afraid of Africa for a long time because everything that I was hearing was what I was hearing from the mainstream media in the States, which is pretty damn negative towards Africa. And as I've met more people who are from Africa and who have traveled like throughout Africa, and also in this book that I just read about Africa, it sounds more and more exciting to me. So I think this is just one more fear that I want to overcome and spend a lot of time there. So I don't have the logistics for it planned yet, but I do plan on when I'm after I'm done with my current list to spend a lengthy amount of time traveling around Africa. Yeah. Let's see. Okay, this question takes the conversation in an entirely different way. So this is from Michelle, and she said, what is the least pleasant thing about traveling as much as you do? Yeah.
I think, you know, one of my least favorite things is when you first land, so you've been on a flight for 15 hours, 20 hours sometimes, and you land and you have that time where you have to find your lodging or your hotel, and you're landing somewhere foreign, you don't speak the language, you don't know where is the metro, is it attached to the airport, do I need to take a taxi, do I have to take a bus or whatever. So that is one of the portions of travel that I probably research the most. When I land, how am I going to get to my hotel? It's just one of those things. I don't know why. I think I still have a little bit of anxiety towards it, just because you're just so foreign and it's so different, so you don't know what to do. So I'll research that. That's probably my least favorite. I love to travel, though, so it's not even that bad. And I think, like we were talking about earlier, sometimes I do miss home. You know, when I'm gone for a really long time, I miss my bed, I miss my husband, I miss my restaurant, you know, I miss things too. So it's nice to come home, but it's nice to go too. So
Disagree with your first part and then totally echo you on the second part. So the first part, one of my favorite parts about traveling is when I land in a new country where I don't speak a language and I don't know what the hell's going on. I love that. I don't know if it's just like these little missions that I like going on, but yeah. That's my favorite part. And I go out of my way to not research it. I don't want to know what currency they use in the country. I don't want to know, much less what the rate is. Like, I love getting those, like, that mess.
kudos to you.
Yeah, it's just something different about me. But I love those little missions. Like, I call those days my airdrop days, where I'll come in a new country. I'm like, okay, how do I get situated here? How do I get lodging? How do I get, an ounce of phone? All these kind of things. So I love those. And the second part that I echo you on completely is the homesickness. So I found that I don't really get lonely. Like maybe every once in a while, but
yeah, I don't either.
I don't really get lonely. I like the time I spend by myself. Turns out when you travel, there's gonna be other people there, right? Like I just got back from Asia for the last 5 months. Today's actually my first day back officially back here. So I'm what I did get was homesick though. So that's different than loneliness. Homesick is when you just miss things you're familiar with. So when I was traveling for all this time just now. I found myself eating at, going to Americanized things more often than I have in past trips. And it was just because I think maybe where I was and different parts of Asia are just so different compared to where I grew up. It was just more of the longing for the familiar and the stability. But it was quickly remedied by all the cool things that I saw and all the really interesting people that I met and all these countries I got to explore. Like, all of those, the pros of those completely outweigh any of the cons that I've felt about homesickness. Yeah.
I would agree. I like what you said, too, about homesickness is different than loneliness, because I'm very similar to you. I really value my time alone with myself. I guess I just, I don't know. I like to be alone sometimes and kind of don't have to worry about other people and just want to do what I want to do or have that time. So I don't get lonely too often, but I do get homesick, yeah.
So let's talk about the solo traveling a bit. So there's a huge myth that exists from a lot of really smart people who say that women cannot travel alone, and you are obviously proving this wrong. Can you talk a little bit about solo traveling as a woman? What's that like?
I don't think it's as scary as people think, and I think it's kind of all in your mind. I think that you should take precautions just like you would anywhere else. You know, in my hometown, I wouldn't walk down a weird alleyway at 1 a.m. by myself. And neither, I wouldn't do that in a different country either. Mm-hmm. So I think, yeah, you just take the same precautions. I really haven't been put in a situation where I was nervous or scared, and I have done some extensive traveling solo, and I don't know, I think it's empowering as a woman to know that you're kind of not restricted in the things that you can go and see and do.
When you did your first solo trip, was there some kind of like process that you went through to prepare for that, or were there people you talked to? How did that work?
No, I don't think there was a process that I went through. I knew kind of, I made a list of the things I definitely wanted to do solo, and I knew, you know, where I was going to go and how I was going to get places, because I wanted to be secure in that way. You know, I didn't want there to be some shadiness going on about me having to catch a taxi at, you know, midnight or something like that. But I don't think there was anything that I really did different than when I travel with somebody else. I just knew that I was going to be a little bit more careful about walking around late, or maybe, you know, whom I talk to, you know, getting a sense and using my intuition in situations.
Mm-hmm. So. Yep, I think that makes a lot of sense. It's I feel that this year, especially when I've been traveling alone, I've met many more solo women travelers, which I think is just really, really great. I'm glad that's something that is changing in a positive way.
Yeah.
Going back to kind of where we were before, so this is a question from Nick. He's asking, what destination disappointed you overall the most? This is an interesting question. Annette, you want to take this one first, and then I'll...
I'm going to start by saying that I love all new places, too. Yeah, you know, I really do. I like to experience new things and see what it's like. And the place that I was disappointed with the most was actually in the United States, and it was... boy, are people going to really hate me that live there? but it was San Antonio, Texas. Man, everybody kept talking about this Riverwalk thing, and I was so excited, and it was just, the whole trip was sort of disappointing. It was more of like a tourist trap, and the restaurants on the Riverwalk weren't that great, and I don't know, it was just, I don't know.
Yeah, I hear you. Sometimes things just get blown out of proportion as far as like the way people talk about them, and if you go in there with a different mindset, or if you go in there... just with some other variable, it's different. I mean, it can totally derail a trip.
And also, Pisa in Italy, too, you know, is one of those, you want to go see the Leaning Tower of Pisa, and you should, but I'm not sure I'd spend the night there. You know, there's not much to do. It's kind of just very, very touristy, but I definitely wanted to see it, so I stayed and left. So those two places, probably.
You did a post recently about, I think, it was something along the lines of, like, your favorite bucket list photos you've taken, and one of them was go ahead.
It was the cheesiest, 17 cheesiest travel photos you have to take.
And this one where you're holding up the,
I love that cheesy stuff. So I totally had to do that,
I hear you. let's see, so disappointing places. So I guess I have two, and I guess I'll give the same disclaimer that Annette gave. So I love traveling, and even when I have some slight disappointments or some trips that don't go as well, the benefits of traveling overall completely outweigh those. And so these are just, I kind of don't like to highlight the negatives because I don't want those to be overblown compared to all the positives I've had from these experiences. But with that said, that's my like little endorsement there or whatnot. So I had a really rough time in Russia, in St. Petersburg and Moscow. I just felt very unsafe and unpleasant and ran into a bunch of situations that just were sucky. And I've heard other people who've gone to those cities and love them, but I had a really, really rough time in both of them. And it was difficult because it was also a very hard country to get out of, and those cities were hard to get out of when I happened to be there. It was also the dead of winter, so you don't want to go to those cities in the dead of winter. I learned that the hard way. And then recently, I went to the Forbidden City, and I've just heard so much about the Forbidden City and read books about it and seen movies about it. When I went, I just felt really disappointed because the hype in my mind did not live up to how it actually was. I felt really more bad about it, to be honest, in that, like, that history, the history that was going on, or the life for the commoners that was going on in China when that was being built was quite sad. It was, in many ways, a sad part of their history. And just to see the amount of luxury that was put into that, like, the trees were grown specifically for the roof, for the support beams you can't even see in, like, mm-hmm. certain buildings there. And that, I just find that to be sad.
Yeah.
And I can appreciate the amount of time and effort and ingenuity that went into building the Forbidden City, but I felt sad. Like, it just seemed so unweighted and equal. Oh, yeah, so that would be mine there. Good question there, Nick.
That's good.
So we got about 5 minutes left, so if anyone has any last-minute questions, feel free to ask them again, lifelisted.com/live, and you can ask the questions through there, through that interface. Unfortunately, like, we have more questions than we're going to have time to answer, so I'm going to see if I can pick out some especially good ones. Here we go. This one is from Craig, and this was on Twitter. He said, what has been the most satisfying thing to check off of your list?
For me, I think the most satisfying is anything that involves helping a person or an animal. Like volunteering at the elephant rescue in Thailand or going to the orphanage in Africa, giving blood was really satisfying. That and also anything that was the scariest, that I really had to overcome a fear, like skydiving. I mean, I don't like to fly already, but then let's fly and let's jump out of a plane. I mean, that's just stupid, right? But after I did it, I felt, oh my God, I was so empowered. I felt like I could do anything. I felt like Superwoman. So those are what satisfies me the most. It doesn't have to be something like expensive or anything. It make you feel good inside, you know?
Yeah. Mine are similar. So I think the most fulfilling ones that I've had have been the ones that I've done with my family. So I've made it a point to positively peer pressure members of my family to do bucket list items with me.
I love that.
Yeah. And they have a hard time coming up with an excuse when I say, oh, I got to get this stuff done and I want you to come with me. So the ones I've done with my family members have been really, really great. And then I agree with you. The ones that I've done with other people or for other people have been the ones that have been most fulfilling, which to say that now, looking back on it, seems so obvious and like something that like is intellectually easy to understand, but it took me a long time to really understand that holistically to get that those would be the... Because part of me is like, I want to do air combat school. That sounds badass. But yeah. And those ones are great, but the ones that are really, really great, the ones that make a big impact on my life.
Right.
Friends and family.
Yeah, for sure.
Nick has a follow-up question. He says, any totally underrated destinations that you recommend? This is a cool question because I like what it's highlighting here.
Oh, boy. You go first on that one. Let me think about that one for a second. Okay.
Shoot, I like when you answer first.
I know!
Yeah, I echo exactly what you're saying.
Like underrated. What she said.
Yeah. Let's see, so underrated. I love, love, love Queensdane, Amsterdam. So it is a big party holiday that they have there that, from what I understand, many people don't know about it within Europe. Things like Tomorrowland, which is a big music festival, gets all the attention. But I loved, loved, loved Queensdane, Amsterdam. Really, really fun and cool and enlightening and cool people and good music. Mm. I loved, loved Borneo. So I spent some time in Brunei. This was not too long ago. And I loved it because I felt completely out of place. It was an entirely new country for me, a new world in some ways. I got to go through like the true rainforest in places I really felt like people had not been to before. That was a lot of fun. We got caught in this big storm, which was really exciting because like the whole, I didn't realize this, but when you have a big storm in a rainforest, not only is there tons of rain, which I guess I expected, you also have like the entire thing falls down on you because the wind and all the trees that are there and all the vegetation just goes everywhere and it's just like being in a big twister or something. So that was fun. So Borneo, specifically Brunei, Darussalam, which is the name of the country there. And then I don't know if this one really counts, but the Maldives or the Maldives. Lots of people have heard of them. They're very luxurious. But what was underrated about it was not staying at the super expensive hotels. It was staying at these small islands and these villages there, like the village islands. That was awesome. So it was dirt cheap and as beautiful as all the postcards you see from that country. But for a fraction of the cost and just super interesting and lively. So I have those three.
Oh, boy, those are good. I mean, I don't know. The only one I can think of, and I'm not sure how underrated it is Tokyo. Mm. A lot of time when I was telling people I was going there, they're like, why would you go to Tokyo? You know, why not go somewhere else? But I loved Tokyo. I think it's so quirky. We went to a cat cafe there, which was the weirdest thing I've ever experienced, where you have coffee and you pet cats. They have, like, dozens of cats.
Like kittens?
Full-grown cats. Yeah, they were just lounging around. You could. It was just the weirdest concept that I had to go and do that. I just thought Tokyo, that, you know, they have the Golden Guy section with over 200 tiny little bars with almost like 6 seats in them, so you can go bar hopping. And this little. They had just so many cool things, and they're so rich in their culture, which I loved about it. So I would totally recommend going to Tokyo.
So I like this. Let's end this on a high note. I have one more question, and then I think we're actually out of time. We're a minute over, but we'll let that pass. So, Annette, if I want to contact you, how do I do that? How do I find more information about you?
Well, my cell phone number – no, just kidding. you can find me at bucketlistjourney.net. You can Google Bucket List Journey, and it'll come up. I'm also on all social media. But you can go to the blog first, and then you'll find all my information.
Excellent. And she's very responsive, so good about that. If for some reason you want to find information with me, or or if for some reason you have to talk to me and tell me not to do something, the best way to find me is at lifelisted.com/about, and all my contact information is there. This video will be up on YouTube, I think actually in the next hour, so if you missed it or you got in late or whatnot, you can find it there. But thank you for watching, really appreciate it. If you have any more questions, I think Annette and I are going to do more events like this. If you found this valuable, let us know so we have that kind of feedback. And most of all, thank you, Annette. I appreciate the
conversation. Oh, thank you. It's been great.
Yep, look forward to more of these in the future. And thanks, everybody, for your time and for your questions.
Thank you.
And we will talk to you later.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, everybody.
Have a good day. Do something different.
Start with this.